Thank you for your time here today. I wanted to talk a little bit about cancer research today, which is a topic you may or may not be interested in. I kind of want to kind of make a wild guess, sort of an assumption, that everyone here has somehow been impacted by cancer. Whether it's been a friend, perhaps, a family member, or I can guarantee you that there are some courageous survivors in this audience. I mean, that's how rampant cancer is. That's what we're dealing with. You know, and how are we gonna sort of stop this? You know, what are we gonna do about this as a human race? So I kind of want to just throw out some statistics to you that, you know, kind of scary for me. I mean, they're kind of frightening. You know, men, 1 in 2, half the men here will develop cancer. 1 in 4 will die of cancer. Ladies, 1 in 3 will develop. 1 in 5 will die of cancer. I mean, that really, really frightens me. We've done a lot, but clearly, there's a lot more that we can do. So I'm a cancer biologist, so I like to study little cancer cells. They're small, you can't see them. They're, you know, a fraction of a millimeter. We use microscopes to see them, and I try to figure out how they behave and how they function, these cancer cells. So today I really wanted to talk to you about hope. Okay, so where does hope live for this dreadful, dreadful disease? What are we gonna do about this? And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about how my laboratory is contributing to this. And I'd like to talk to you about how, you know, us as an international cancer research community is handling this. So we have been very interested in understanding, you know, the biology behind cancer. We've been very fascinated by this for a while. And I want to kind of set a context for you. I want to set a stage for you to understand how we've been treating cancer and how we've thought about cancer for a really long time. And I could use just a little of a personal story. So I'm going to work one day. I'm leaving the front door. Or I'm running out trying to catch a meeting or whatever. I close the door, wave goodbye to my kids through the window, you know, hustle into the car, and I go to start the car up, right? And turn the key, right? And car doesn't start. I look up, and there's now smoke coming out of the hood of my car, right? So, you know, look up again. Now my kids that were once waving, you know, are now laughing at me, right? Because what could be funnier, right, than dad's car with smoke coming out of it, right? So I think about, you know, I got to do something here, right? I got to do something about this. So, okay, what am I going to do? And I go, you know, I want to go lift up the hood, right? So about 10 minutes later, I find the hood release. And, you know, and I go to the front. I know nothing about cars, right? So I lift it up. And indeed, right, there's smoke coming out of the car, right? So, but I think, right, you know, and I'm not a mechanic, but I think that smoke is probably not the cause of the problem, right? There's probably something wrong behind it, right? Maybe, you know, maybe the engine's broken, maybe the carburetor fell off, or the steering wheel, you know, is turned the wrong way. I don't know. But I could guarantee you that it's not the smoke, right? There's something else. The smoke is here, but there's an underlying cause. And that's really an analogy for how we've understood cancer for a while. We've understood the symptoms, for instance, of cancer, what's going on at the surface. But we haven't understood really the underlying cause. And I mean at the molecular level. What is driving the cancer at the molecular level? We've known the symptoms, but what's happening at the molecular level? So what are these symptoms that I'm talking about, right? What am I talking about? Well, I'm going to show you some videos. So my laboratory makes videos of cancer cells. And we look at how they function. These are sort of one of a kind. And what you have in front of you is a video of breast cancer cells. So these are 20 breast cancer cells. Watch what happens over 3 days. That's how they grow. They proliferate. I mean, this is scary, right? I mean that's sort of the same feeling that I have. Look at them go. They proliferate quickly. This is a symptom, we'll say, of cancer, proliferation or growth. So what's fascinating about this is that people who have cancer don't actually die from the growth. It's actually not that. We actually look at the movement of cancer. This is another symptom. Most people die from the spread. Watch these lung cancer cells. They're in the bottom left and the top right, and there's a gap in between. Watch how they move. This is overnight underneath a microscope. This is known as metastasis. This is known as the spread of cancer. When you hear malignancy, this is what we're talking about. All right, so these are the symptoms. We have growth and we have spread or movement, right? But again, you know, what is the underlying cause of this? What is happening at the molecular level that is causing this to happen? So I want to start off with a little bit of a history. I think this is really helpful. So these are your chromosomes, right? We have 46 of them, right? 23 pairs, okay? On the chromosomes is our DNA code. 3 billion letters, 3 billion letter code. Well, back in the 1990s, the United States government said, I want to sequence the entire DNA code, all 3 billion letters. And this entire code is known as the genome, okay? So the project was called the Human Genome Project, right? And this got a lot of fanfare and media press, and it took about 2 decades to do this, 2 decades, and it cost about $3 billion, so about $1 a letter in the code, basically. So it took quite a while, and we learned a lot of biology, for sure. We learned a lot about it. Fast forward to today, right now, the technology that we have right now, okay, instead of costing $3 billion, it costs a few thousand dollars. Okay, and instead of taking a couple decades, it now takes a couple weeks. So this is major, major jump in technology. This is great. We could do this quicker and faster, and it's only going to get better. We're going to do it for under $1,000, okay, and it's going to take a few days, and perhaps we may not even do one human genome, we could do many at the same time. So this is great, we have this great technology, but what about cancer, right? What does this mean for cancer? Okay, well this is the important point. If we could sequence normal cells, we can sequence cancer cells, right? It's obvious, it's logical. So imagine this scenario, every patient who comes into the clinic could have their specific cancer sequenced. And this is really, really important because by understanding the sequence of the cancer, we could then uncover the molecular changes that occur in their specific cancer. These changes are known as mutations, so we could uncover the molecular mutations for everybody's cancer. This has serious therapeutic implications. Okay, which I'm going to get to. But there's also challenges, right? So we paint a very nice picture, but like everything else, there's challenges. You know, there are challenges that range from how are we going to store all this data, big data, it's a popular topic, to privacy, to biology. And that's one of the things that we work on, is that we are trying to contribute to this, as cancer biologists, contribute to this international effort. So what are we doing? Well, this year is a real lung cancer. This is what happens when someone gets a biopsy, okay, and it goes to a pathologist. This is what it looks like. If you look at it, it's not all the same. There are cancer cells in there. There's patterns that form. There are normal cells around it. The cancer's in the middle in that pattern. So if we're gonna sequence the entire tumor, the entire cancer, what about the small cancer cells, the really rare cancer cells that we know are extremely, extremely important? They're just gonna get lost in the greater population. How do I go in and say, I want this cancer cell? These guys are tiny. These guys are like fractions of a millimeter. How do I pick what I want? How do I know which is the bad cancer cell? How do I know which is the ringleader? And that's what we're trying to do here. So this is a model that we create. These are cancer cells. It's a big ball of cancer cells with all the cells coming out of it. And you can see they form these finger-like patterns. Okay? Play it for you one more time. Look how they spread out. There's some cells that come out first. These we call them leader cells or pioneer cells. There are some cells that come out behind. We call them follower cells. And there are some cells that never come out. We know those leader cells at the front are really, really important. They may, in fact, drive the spread and the metastasis. So it's logical, then, we need to know what changes occur. We need to know what changes occur to target it, to treat it. And I'll show you how smart these guys are. Watch, here comes out a single leader cell. And watch what it does. It comes out, and watch, it makes a U-turn to go get its followers. It makes a U-turn. It communicates with other cells. Play it for you one more time. Comes out, and it'll make a U-turn. It wants to have followers, but what makes this cell special? What makes it important? And how do I pick these cells and pull them out? So this is kind of fascinating for us. So this is a cool technology. This is something we just developed. We did it in the past year, and it combines existing technologies in a novel way. This is a palette of cancer cells. It's a green palette. They have a special protein that comes from a jellyfish that someone won the Nobel Prize for about five or seven years ago. All the cells here, there's a couple hundred cells, they're green because of this special protein. But it's a really unique green. If we shine laser light on it, it could turn red. Okay? So we could precisely define an area the size of a cell, even smaller if we wanted to, and turn that specific cell red. Okay? So what we've created is an optical highlighter. Just like you would highlight a book and say, okay, I want this word, I want this letter, we say, I want this cell. Okay? So these guys are small. Let me just show you a sort of, maybe it's a little bit of a gimmick, but I'll show it to you. So you could see, we could turn those specific cells red. I mean, these guys are like fractions of a millimeter. And we could pick whatever cells we want. And look how precise it is. None of the other cells around it turn red, right? Look at that precision. And you could go back and see it. It's extremely precise. Okay, so what do we do with this technology besides making, you know, silly TEDx logos? This is our cell zapping microscope. Okay? So you could see the screen on the right, and we could choose what cells we want, and we zap the cells, and they turn red like I just showed you. Then we send it through another existing technology, okay? And I kind of have a little animation here about it. Look at all the green cells go through, but now we zap the red cell. So there's our red cell, and they're very rare. 1 in 10,000, maybe. It gives a charge, and that single red cell could end up by itself in a well. It's like a filter. We could sort out those red cells by themselves. We could even drop a single red cell into a well using this technology. It's that sensitive. So it's quite cool, and that's how we actually pull out the cells that we want. Okay, so what does this look like? I spoke about those leader cells, right? So what you have there is a leader cell, it's in green, okay, and there's a white outline around the front of the cell. And on the right side, you have the red, okay? When we convert it to red, watch how it goes up. The red goes up, okay, and not only does the red go up, but the green color goes down at the same time. So we can pick whatever cell that we want, and we in a live cell environment, these cells are alive at the time, and choose what we want, and then we sequence it. And then we sequence it, and then we're able to determine the precise DNA code of that cancer cell. What we hope, and that's where we are right now, what we hope is that this will reveal an entirely new signature, a new DNA signature that we could use to identify these cells and kill these cells. And that's our goal. So what does all this mean, right? What's the bigger picture here? 1.6 million people will be diagnosed with cancer this year. I mean, that's what we're dealing with. I think all of this technology that I've been talking about, that we've been doing and other people, has two major implications. First off, it's going to change the way we classify cancer. Okay, previously we said lung cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer. and we thought about where it came from. Instead, we got to classify it on the molecular level. What has changed? And this is happening right now. We are thinking about cancers entirely differently. We are reclassifying cancer and saying, well, it's not just lung cancer. You have lung cancer with these specific mutations. And that's really, really important for treatment. Okay, and the second point is treatment. Why is this important for treatment? Okay, we have our blue people and we have our red people, right? They're all diagnosed with lung cancer. Previously, we'd say we treat you all the same. Okay, all six people here are treated the same. But that shouldn't be the case. Because when we sequence, we know that their cancers are not the same. All cancers are not created alike. They're actually different diseases. Okay? Now, we know that the red people have changes in genes A and B. Okay? And the blue people have changes in genes C and D. So we know that they're different. They're different diseases. So for people who have changes in genes A and B, we treat it with treatment one, and we already have treatment one, and it's great, and it works, and it's very, very effective. With people with genes C and D, mutations in genes C and D, we give them treatment two, and maybe we don't have treatment two yet, but we're working on it. That's what's going to take time. This whole concept is called personalized cancer medicine, because we're personalizing treatment. It also goes by the name personalized oncology as well. But this here is the biggest change we're going to make. So it's not some fantastic new treatment. Instead, we are treating people more logically than we ever had before. In fact, we may need to bring back or resurrect failed drugs because maybe we weren't giving them to the right people, right? Maybe we need to give them back and give them to the right people. So I want to end just on a more of a personal note. This here is Jonathan Hicks. He's 28 years old, diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. Lung cancer has a 15% survival rate after 5 years. Only 15% of the people are alive. There is no stage 5. He never smoked a day in his life. Because of personalized cancer medicine, he had his tumor sequenced, okay? Found out that he had a change, and we had a treatment for it. We have a treatment for it. So he's now alive today because of personalized cancer medicine. He got married. He even made a short film about it called Nirvana. This is where the promise is. This is the next great revolution in cancer treatment. Thank you for your time.